amazing how this world was made. I wonder if God is a woman. The gift of life astounds me to this day. I give it up for the woman. She's the constant wind that fills my sail, oh, that woman. With a smile and a star, she'll protect you like a child, that's a woman. She'll put a smile.
Good evening, good evening, good evening, and welcome to Women at Work on this Monday, November 3rd, 2008. Tomorrow's election day.
Where, Virginia?
In where else?
You didn't say?
Well, I'm just figuring, you know, a lot of folks probably already know.
Who the next president of the United States is going to be?
Oh, I think Obama. You know, even if he doesn't, it's historical anyway.
Right.
You
right.
know, so,
right.
you know, those of you that... that vote, you know, you got to practice what you preach. And so I always tell people in Belize that they should vote. So
you voted, Virginia?
Yes, I voted.
Good for you.
Yes, I did. And I have with me my sister friend, Miss YaYa Marin Coleman.
Good night, Belize.
And we have a guest in the house this evening. He's no stranger to KREM. His name is Nuri Akbar, Brother Nuri. Thank you for coming tonight.
Glad to be here.
Yeah. They've been fussing at me all evening about putting Nuri in the middle, but I say when I have to, when it's good to have a man in the middle sometimes.
To
emphasize the importance it is for men and women to work together.
Clean that up real good, Virg. I agree with you.
But you jump, you know. It is important. You know, so that we know that men also recognize the different social ills. And that is what we're talking about this month. We're talking about the social ills of society. What are they and what do you do about them? So I met Nuri almost a year ago. Is that right?
Since February.
Since February. Well, that's almost a year.
Almost a year.
That's almost a year. And I have known him to be not only a social activist, but a youth activist. And so I thought it was very special that he be here to start off the social ills, because he has been here enough, and with his experience in Los Angeles and coming here, he has really been able to assess what's going on. And I think that he's the kind of person that would speak out how you feel about what you've seen and what you actually feel we could do to do something about it. And I'm not talking about the government, I'm talking about the people. So
yes.
Welcome to Women at Work.
I'm glad to be here.
Okay.
And good night to my sister, YaYa.
Okay. What's up, black man? So tell us, Nuri, tell us a little bit about yourself.
First.
In terms of
whatever you want the public to know about you.
Well, what I would like to share with the public is that I'm one of those Belizeans who was away for a period of time physically, but I've always been engaged in activities that is related to the concerns of Belize. So even though I was away physically, I was always involved with work that applies to our circumstances here in Belize. I've been here in the country since February of this year, primarily volunteering with various groups and agencies and individuals. That was not necessarily planned that way. I came to spend a month, and as you can see, I'm still here.
Okay.
And that decision was driven mostly by the circumstances and realities that I discovered and saw when I came here to Belize, that compelled me to have extended my stay. My work goes back to the activist work in the community in Los Angeles. That goes all the way back to 1983.
Okay.
As a student activist, starting at Los Angeles City College, and then that spread into the Belize Caribbean community.
Okay.
Most Belizeans, just today I met a few people who apparently had remember the radio program that we did in Los Angeles, the Belize Caribbean Pulse.
Mm-hmm.
That program was vital to the community and lasted for a decade. I was associated with that program through the organization Breda.
Mm-hmm.
And fast forwarding to today, many of the issues that we were discussing back then,
mm-hmm.
whether it was the Maritime Areas Act, whether it was violence, whether it was Belize being turned into a transshipment point for the shipment of cocaine coming from South America, going up north.
Mm-hmm.
These are all issues that we were discussing
mm-hmm.
back in the late 1980s, early 1990s.
Mm-hmm.
And so some of them apparently has come home, unfortunately, I might say.
Mm-hmm.
And as you said in the beginning of the program, we want to look at some of these issues, but also try to put them in some context so that we can understand what is unfolding,
right.
And hopefully we can have some solutions to them. That's in a nutshell.
Thanks. Last week on, I don't know how many of you after Women at Work listened to Read and Reason, but Read and Reason was an interview. They read an interview with Brother Nuri and Pam Reyes. And I know most of Belize knows Pam Reyes for the articles that she used to write in the Amandala.
Well, I actually, that was one of my weaknesses. I did not put that interview in context. So, and I'm thinking you'll refer to it and ask Nuri to elaborate. So Nuri, before you do it, if you put the interview in context, that would greatly be appreciated.
Well, Dr. Pam Reyes
mm-hmm.
is a Belizean who have been living in Los Angeles for many years.
Okay.
And she came on board and was a contributor to the Breda organization in Los Angeles.
Mm.
She became involved with the media.
You're saying Breda, spell it.
Breda.
B-R-E-D-A-A.
Okay.
Stands for the Belize Rural Economic Development of Agriculture Through Alliance. Breda.
Breda.
Yes. So Dr. Pam Reyes, who is a Belizean that have been living abroad for many years, she became involved with the work that we were doing.
Mm-hmm.
She volunteered and she became one of the announcers on the radio program.
Mm-hmm.
And that was her involvement with the work that we were doing. She asked me several years later in 1990 to do this interview. And because we were approaching that millennium date, she wanted me was to reflect on what some of the things that is affecting our society, our country, our nation, and then look at some of the possibilities and some of the future events that will continue to shape our country.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was a context.
And politically we were on
that,
the heel
of that interview.
Was it on the heel of the UDP election, that time frame?
Well, yes, there was a general elections in 1998. So this came after that election, this interview that you were reading last week.
Okay.
Now, in the interview, I noticed that you had discussed issues that you see happening right now in Belize, and that was one of the things that I felt that the other two young brothers that were giving their viewpoint.
Yes, Jorge Zelaya and Kieran Rock.
They gave their impression, and one of them finally said, well, but that's happening now.
Right.
And there was another point that was brought out as far as role models and if and colors and gangs, and there was a big comparison. Are you finding all of that still happening right here in Belize as we speak, and then as it was in the past?
Almost 10 years later.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I'm certainly not the first and only person to have pointed out these things. We have had several other prominent people in the community who have written. The owner and publisher of the Amandala, Mr. Evan Hyde, has has spoke and wrote extensively on some of these issues. But in terms of what we are facing now, I have to put some historical context to this. In brief, in 1798, there was a decisive battle that occurred in this place that we are sitting and standing today, that was to shape the destiny of this country. That was the Battle of St. George's Key that took place on the 10th of September. But what is important about that incident is that in 1804, the Haitian Revolution peaked. Now, I'm mentioning these dates because when we talk about this historical battle, we never connect it to the regional movement for freedom that was occurring. Okay? So that decisive battle that happened here in 1798 predated the Haitian Revolution that peaked in 1804. And then, of course, in the mid to early 1800s, we had the Monroe Doctrine that was introduced in this hemisphere. Now, I'm saying these things, but I'm going to connect these dots as we speak, because all of these things are affecting Belize today. Okay? But it is critical that we understand that our ancestors, through their decisiveness, through their boldness, stood up and made a decision that they will not run any further and put up a fight that formed the foundation of what we call Belize today. The Haitian Revolution is significant because that is recorded as the first slave, major slave rebellion in this region that was to be successful. Okay? And it had a direct impact on the colonial powers of the day, primarily, of course, France. France was impacted greatly, to the point where Napoleon had to sell the Louisiana connection to raise funding for his military expeditions. Okay. It affected the British presence in this region, and it affected the Spaniards as well. You fast forward that, and you come to look at what we have evolved to. We became, quote unquote, independence in 1981. We were given a constitution that was a carbon copy that was given essentially to most of the members of the Commonwealth. Today, we are grappling with that. There have been movements of amendments. There have been some changes here and there in terms of some of our institutions. But the term decolonization, which was a part of the process that the British introduced when it was going through the granting of independence to its former colonies. Decolonization is an academic term, but really it refers to an accommodation period. Rather than the native people rising up and changing their circumstances, there was a process of accommodation called decolonization, meaning that none of the institutions that was established by the colonial master would be disturbed. That includes the educational system, that includes our judiciary, that includes our legislative branch, it includes our civil service system, etc., etc. So they made sure that by bringing us into quote-unquote independence, none of the fundamental institutions that was to form the basis of this modern nation state called Belize today would remain intact. Now, the question that we have to ask ourselves as a people is, they say we are now 27 years after independence, if you want to use 1981 as the beginning point. Some would argue that it should go all the way back to that battle that I mentioned in the beginning. In 1798, okay? why have we not taken ownership of these institutions? Why have we not taken ownership of the document that formed the basis of all the laws of this nation? Why have we not taken ownership of our educational institutions, drafting and forming and building and molding the curriculums that is applicable, mm-hmm. that is relevant to our circumstances as a people? The former president of Tanzania, Julius Nyerere, once said that education can be liberating, but education can be as well, it can be oppressive. So we have to ask the question, if our educational system is not producing the type of learning, the type of awareness that can move our nation forward, then we have to look at that system. We have to look at it seriously. So I just want to lay the context for this conversation,
mm-hmm.
okay? And we can proceed from here. But it's with that backdrop that we are now facing some of the challenges that we are now facing.
So what are some of those challenges that you can see that, well, we always say economics is always part of it, but then other than economics, what other challenges have you identified?
Well, one of the things, and I like the introduction that he gave to the other social ills that we could always identify, which would be housing, health, education, economics, all these things are a part of it. One of the things that I remember hearing clearly is that we, people of African descent, are the only people known to leave the education of our children in the hands of the oppressors,
mm-hmm.
instead of taking ownership for the education of our children, because when the oppressors or former oppressors, however you like to word it, are responsible for miseducating our children ourselves, who are we to blame but ourselves? But I think there's enough blame to go around. So if you connect the dots, Nuri, and fast forward, continue your story from the historical aspect, which many of us do not know or do not connect that to the relevance of what we're dealing with today. And more than ever, that is by design.
I would say first and foremost, we still have
mm-hmm.
an identity crisis in our country
mm-hmm.
as a people. Identity brings cohesion. Cohesion builds strong nationalism,
mm-hmm.
something that we have all been very concerned about in terms of the evolution of Belize as a modern nation state. Okay. Therefore, going back to the issue of education, and when I speak of education, I don't speak of education in terms of institutionalized education.
Mm-hmm.
I speak of education in the broader sense of the term,
mm-hmm.
the dissemination of information that would empower the individual
mm-hmm.
towards self-determination. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not speaking merely of
formal
institutionalized
education.
Formal education.
Right.
Okay. That type of awareness has to be advanced, must be advanced. And that can be advanced in different format. What the KREM Mandala project is doing is that type of popular education. So again, it's about the dissemination of information that would empower the individual, and by empowering the individual, you empower the group,
mm-hmm.
the society. It has to be more of that. And that has to be coordinated, that has to be organized, it mm-hmm. has to be systematic. Coupled with that, of course, we have to deal with our economic circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
I gave the historical background because Belize have all the natural ingredients to become a dynamic and stable nation in light of the global meltdown that we are now witnessing. We have natural resources here that is indeed untold, whether it's the oil, whether it's the arable land for agricultural production, whether it is the rivers and the seas that we have that is rich,
mm-hmm.
and there are other minerals. Of course, the most important natural resources that we have is our people.
Mm-hmm.
Because we are a small developing country, I have to bring in the diaspora.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot, and I will continue to say this, until it burns into our brain. You cannot have a national program for development without including, when you have a small population as we do, mm-hmm. including your diaspora. You simply cannot. Okay. What do we have? We have a little over 300,000 people, mm-hmm. and it is now estimated that perhaps we have up to 100,000 Belizeans, mm-hmm. first and second generation, living in a diaspora. Many of these people have vital and important contribution to make towards our development. Mm-hmm. But if there is not a policy, a clear policy, that incorporate the diaspora in a systematic and organized way towards our national development, then that is a part of our natural resources that we are not maximizing. Just like the oil, just like the sea, just like the river and the other minerals. So that's number one. Okay. Number two, we need to train and educate our people in the areas that is critical to development. And the areas that are critical to development are the areas that brings technical expertise. Mm-hmm. So when we had the demise of the technical college some years ago, which has not been duplicated, where you train your engineers, you train your plumbers, you train your electricians, all the vital areas that is necessary to build the infrastructure of your nation.
But don't they have the IT vet in the schools like that, the vocational schools? That's not the same? Or that's not leading into it? The technical training?
Whatever it is that they offer, to my understanding, is not at the level where technical was. And it doesn't offer as many programs as it did at technical. And looking at the students, for the most part, who are coming out of these IT vet schools compared to the students that were coming out of technical, there's a vast disparity, to my understanding. Mm-hmm. No disrespect, IT vet.
The general point that I'm advancing here mm-hmm. is that as a developing country, mm-hmm. we must train our citizens in the areas of expertise that pertain to the technical skills that we need mm-hmm. to take us forward. Mm-hmm. We are not doing that at the level that we should. So we are looking all over the region to find people with these various skills.
Mm-hmm. Let me give our phone numbers. 222-4299, 202-4469, 202-4409. We're going to take our first break, and we'll be back with the phone lines open.
I'm single, I'm not dating anyone right now.
Try to live my life to the fullest.
Yeah, when I want something, I just keep going until I get it.
I like to party.
Because if a man doesn't have any pride, if he doesn't have any confidence in himself, he won't care, okay?
I just can't stay home. Not me. I'm not ashamed to cry because then that wouldn't make me a man.
Beside every great man, there's a great woman is not behind.
She's the constant wind that fills my sail.
She's the constant wind that fills my sail. That's a woman.
That's right.
Yes,
isn't it great to be a black woman, Virginia?
I'm telling you. You can't imagine.
And you're flanked by two beautiful ones, uh-huh. Nuri?
Yes.
We have in studios tonight Sister YaYa, Marin Coleman, and then also Brother Nuri Akbar. Nuri, we're talking this month and we're starting the conversation and you're putting everything in perspective that's going to assist us throughout this month to kind of carry on what you're starting. So, well, you want to continue to lay the groundwork for us because it
connect the dots.
Yes, we're talking about the. If you're just tuning in, we're talking about the social ills of society and what to do about them. Brother Akbar had an interview with Dr. Pam Reyes, and they read it on Read and Reason last week, and that even inspired me more to have him come on to talk about the social ills of society and identifying them and finding out what the challenges are to do something about them.
And in the first half hour, Nuri gave us a historical perspective,
right,
which is a part that many of us are missing or don't know, to show the relevance of why we are where we are and how we may work on resolving these issues. Right, Nuri?
That's correct. And the fourth part of that historical equation that I want to mention is the introduction of the Monroe Doctrine of this, for this region. And essentially what that meant was the United States flexing and promoting its hegemony of the Central, South, and North American region. And that was to lay the groundwork for the United States foreign policy, leading all the way up to the current times as we speak. So how did that tie into Belize?
Is that Monroe, like the President Monroe?
Yes, it was President Monroe, mm-hmm, who presented a list of positions, mm-hmm, that the United States was taking in regards to this hemisphere, mm-hmm, the Western Hemisphere. And what was included in those positions, one of them was that the United States was saying that all these countries, they considered now their backyard under their sphere of influence. And as I said, this was to form the basis of the United States foreign policy in this region, mm-hmm, which in some cases was a bloody one, was a vicious one, was a very dominant one. And there are many issues and cases of examples of that, whether it was Chile under Salvador Allende, whether it was El Salvador, whether it was Anastasio Somoza of Nicaragua, whether it was Baby Doc in Haiti, whether it was Batista in Cuba, the footprints are all over the region. How does that tie into Belize? It ties directly into Belize with the Webster proposals. The Webster proposals was a document President Lyndon B. Johnson had selected a New York lawyer by the name of Bethel M. Webster to mediate this quote-unquote dispute between Belize and Guatemala. Mm. In that document, the Webster proposal, there was three very profound things that was put forward. One, that Belize's national economy was to come under the control of the central government of Guatemala. Mm. That our defense was to come under the central government of Guatemala. And thirdly, that our foreign policy was to come under the supervision and control of the central government of Guatemala, which essentially meant the annexation of Belize. Now, this was presented as an option, mm-hmm, for Belize, backed by the United States. This is very important. When we discuss what is happening now, okay, it is important. In fact, I feel that it is critical that we understand what that meant. Mm-hmm. That it was proposed on several occasions for the annexation of Belize to Guatemala. Okay? So when we fast forward to today, when we were told that the Maritime Areas Act was the best possible option to bring to a conclusion this issue with Guatemala, 1991, 1992. The Honorable Philip Goulson felt so strongly about that issue, mm-hmm, as we know, that he protested strongly, mm-hmm, against it. Mm-hmm. Now we fast forward to 2008, and we are being told now that this issue, the best option that we have, is going to the ICJ, the International Court of Justice, and this is the best option for Belize at this point in time. To my mind, this is an issue that must be taken very seriously by every single nationalistic Belizean. I hope that we are not frightened away as a people because of the size of Guatemala, because of its military history of brutality, brutality of its own people, vicious brutality. That must be remembered at all times. Okay? Guatemala, up until very recently, had the worst human rights record in the Western Hemisphere. So even though they have had elections of recent, that is a part of the militaristic culture of Guatemala. And that is still intact. So I'm saying all of this to tie it in to the historical context that I mentioned at the top of this program. So my position is that we should have a vigorous discussion and debate on this issue, look at all sides, and then as a people,
the issue, the Guatemalan issue? No.
This issue of going to the world court.
Okay.
Remember, I mentioned deliberately that we were told that the Maritime Areas Act was the best option to seal, to bring this issue to a close. We are essentially being told the same thing this time around. Okay. And the whole question of the demarcation of our borders. I agree with Senator House that indeed the United Nations granted us, affirm the borders, its self-determination as an independent nation, and that was affirmed by the world body. And now we are being told that there might be some questions in regard to the demarcation of our borders as we know them to be. And as Mose have asked the question on his show, I believe, this morning, what does Belize have to lose by going through this process? The possibility that the borders as we know it can be altered.
How is that relevant to what's going on with our youth?
Absolutely.
Oh, with the social ills.
It is relevant because what it shows is that there are great interests, both historically and contemporary times, in this little place called Belize, and that we are disposable items. So understand that that carnage that you see happening on the street, the introduction of cocaine, the incarceration of our young men, and the climate where the life is devalued to that point is a part of that whole process of eliminating any type of problem issue that would continue to be. Remember, it's important to note, and it's not by accident, that the people who have always stood up, going all the way back to 1798, is your people and my people. I want us to connect these dots. We have been constantly been in a process of resistance, and that has not changed.
But would you consider that the challenge then? I mean, the challenge is to change it.
The challenge is self-preservation.
I feel
and
like
at
in
this
absence...
point, at this point, I try to tie in the international realities that is affecting this society. Nothing is happening here by accident. That is my main point that I'm trying to emphasize. Cocaine did not come here by accident. The fact that the prison is filled with our young black men is not by accident. And there is no huge outcry. The fact that our young men are dropping out of school and don't know how to read or write. Mm-hmm. They don't have skills to survive because of the way our educational institutions are structured. So we have a lot of those young men that you see out there don't have the basic skill to survive in this society, in this system. Mm. They survive because as human beings, that is our instinct to survive. So they find a way to survive. We don't have the death penalty, but they're carrying out executions. Is that correct? So my point is that none of these things are happening by accident.
Or in isolation.
Or in isolation.
So how are they being? Are they being designed and explain that?
If there's a lot of people that is interested in this society, mm-hmm. in this place, mm-hmm. not interested in me and you, mm-hmm. they're interested in the place mm-hmm. that sits, perhaps, it has been reputed, mm-hmm. perhaps have the largest deposits of petroleum in this region. Now that is very critical, that's significant. Given the whole global issue of oil.
So you're saying that somebody is sitting back saying, we're gonna keep these black people down?
I presented a clear historical yes. track record.
Yes.
of a consistent pattern mm-hmm. for the annexation of this place called Belize. Mm-hmm. And I deliberately laid it out mm-hmm. so that we can understand that what is happening now mm-hmm. is not by accident.
We have a call. Good night, caller.
Assalamu alaikum, sister.
Wa alaikum
assalam. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam, brother.
I'm locked into this conversation. As we speak, we just thought that there's been another gruesome murder in the streets of Belize just about an hour ago. Mm. And it's tragic because it's another black brother gunned down in the streets like a pig. Tonight, you know, I feel kind of empty because I know the youngsters, you know, most of the youngsters when they drop, I know that. And it's kind of painful and tragic. But with all this said and done now, I think that it's time for we start to play a game with we people and with the law, the people in the streets, the whole judiciary, the whole thing is laid out in a funky level. The reason why I'm saying that is that the whole setup with this mass immigration and infiltration of we country is a design. And nobody seems to want to have given a conquerability. Even from this old Mr. Philip, when they tried to get Mr. Philip a sign thing, passport business, then they got all the illegal permanent residency. And nobody never got back and deal with that issue there. Then people live out in Belize as normal Belizeans. Again, the black community have been deprived of jobs, of opportunities. You got right at Belize City, right, Chuck. Nobody is talking to me because everybody play politics. Most jobs is created in Belize City. Most of them same politicians get jobs in the community. But the people will come for the job, or will get the job, the people where they way out district and they can way their tongue can work. And there is no job creation that for their community. Also, we need to deal with a situation where people go to court and can't get no real justice. When a young boy and go out and get a problem and then go to court, the whole turn around, the whole process is left out as though like make them feel like as though nobody not caring. And everybody will do me something and just let it go and make them go to the court system for a day or two, for a week or two, and then find the case drop. You never know see your case drop. Somebody start take revenge for themselves. Plus, you got people that got them big money with them people that out of national treasure. Then SSD money and then DFC money and then BTL money and Intelco money. All the money they cause a big havoc in the community because people use their money to try cause anarchy. And finally, the betrayal of real leaders. We have to stop beating the leaf. Real leaders have betrayed us long ago. When they signed the Rampal, when they went into the Rampal Reichardt agreement, and then run me into an adjacent zone business where there is no defined grid lines or number to say you have a border. All the nastiness say the Westview system did to us intentionally, and like the brother rightfully says, by design. They know where they do. Remember Mr. Bauer Megana Guatemala one time by itself, we say he got land Spanish. Then Mr. Musa Megana one time by itself, he said he got land Spanish. Are you going to end your country, the enemy of your country, to land Spanish on a Cayman delegation with you? You don't know where you say we eat the way Ghana. I ain't like this. I ain't up by saying this much, man. Wednesday.
All right.
Wednesday.
No, he's talking about a meeting we're having.
In regards to what happened tonight with the murders in court, Wednesday. We need to try to have one of these situations in a Port Loyola, Red Cross on the Muslim school, in the basketball court. One session where we could meet the business community, ministers of government, police commissioner, anybody with concern, business community, embassies, anybody with concern, to come in and hear some of the youngsters' voice. And maybe we can find some solution to some of the problem, because the government can't find no solution because they don't have no intention of finding no solution when they use crime as an element to hide frenzy and to hide the disasters where they go out economically in this country. Please, we need to stop giving them ease and holiday and step down the judiciary. You want to tell me only me one crazy for no say a man can't be judged according to the law of this country? Then only me one crazy. But nobody no want to deal with that issue. And then the same issue, the brother, affect we in the streets, because we see when the rich man picking and commit another crime, and then say one buy a bullet and bring it in a free wood and give it. But then police not rub them down, or police are rubbing down as we move. We gonna leave the lacats and hurry run me down and lock you up for 2 48 hours. But continue to come out of custom left fire center with $1 million worth of drugs. And nobody can touch and nobody can kiss and we that we only mean that she's gonna pay for it. Man, we need help. The community need help. All the intellectuals like to hide and they hide and they hide. They need to come forward and bring themselves up with an issue. No? Otherwise, I still believe that like Haiti, home invasion and be one common thing where affect all of it because people look for them food to eat on a daily basis. Salaam alaikum.
Wa alaikum salaam.
Reverend, just want to share this. He came by today. There's a grassroots organization called Street Inks, and the flyer says, presents our thoughts, possible solutions, a presentation from youths, street men, and community leaders in addressing crime and violence, also possible solution, sports skills and safety. And some of the speakers will be from the Therese Felix Foundation, Patrick Rogers from the Commoners, youths from the Port Loyola area, COLA official and citizens. And this will be on November 5th, 2008. That will be this Wednesday from 7 o'clock to 9:15 p.m. at the Central American Boulevard and Farmers Road at the Farron Felix Basketball Court this Wednesday. And one of the things that I thought was interesting, Nuri, I remember when you first appeared on WB, you said, in order for us to solve many of these issues, the people would have to be involved, and not necessarily those in government, because whenever it appears that they are, it doesn't work. That the people have to be involved from the communities that are being affected. And so right away when I saw this flyer, I thought about you saying that. And so that's again, people, this Wednesday night, 7 o'clock to 9:15 p.m. at the Farron Felix Basketball Court on the corner of Central American Boulevard and Farmers Road.
My concern is that we're talking about history and how we got where we are, and we're talking about things that are by design. Now, if we, for so many years, have been identifying those social ills that are by design, Then what is it now that we can do about it?
We have another call.
I know. Good night, caller.
Good night, good night.
Thanks for calling.
Good night, folks.
Good night.
The
good night.
Delivery of the young man in the middle there. I didn't catch the beginning of the show, so I don't know the name, but...
Nuri
the brother, Nuri Akbar.
Nuri Akbar.
Sir, it was pretty well presented.
Uh-huh.
I applaud you for that. My concern, a lot of people who have the facts on this situation does not seem to know how to present the difference between the 13 proposal, the 17 proposal, the heads of agreement, the maritime acts, and our demarcation of the borders. The caller who called earlier, he raised some good points, but my concern with him is it's about time we stop playing the blame game. I believe that the youth of this country should learn how to improvise on the knowledge that we have when it comes to the opportunity. When I was growing up, I was taught that if you know exactly what you don't want, then that's solving half your problem. You can go as far as you can go in school when it comes to education, but if you don't have a little common knowledge, then you have a problem, a very, very big problem. I want to add to the show tonight by saying I hope that a lot of Belizean brothers and sisters, young Belizean brothers and sisters, are paying attention because the ICJ, I personally believe, they too have their own agenda, being influenced by America and the UK. And I believe that if we go there, it wouldn't be a good thing for Belize, what's left of Belize. And finally, I also believe that we are being invaded socially, and a lot of people are not paying any attention to it. I leave you with that. Good night.
Thank you.
Thanks for your call.
Boy, that was a good one.
Yes.
We are being invaded socially.
Yes, yes, yes. We have another call. Caller, thanks for calling. Go ahead with your question.
No, break.
Oh, sorry.
All right, we'll take our next break and we'll be back.
Got it. Belize Medical Associates is continuing to offer you 10% discount on emergency.
It's a constant wind that fills ourselves.
Constant.
Okay. I'm enjoying the conversation because I'm not understanding it all, but I am, as you go along, Brother Nuri, I am getting the gist of, you know, what you're saying and how you're bringing it together. So if I have this confused look on my face, it's only because I'm trying to, you know, understand the whole, because as I was saying, we're going to be doing this for the whole month. And so following this show, I will be trying to contact others that know about what these social ills are, because when I was thinking of social ills and what created those problems in society, of course you talk about exploitation and you talk about violence and crime and corruption, but you're going with the history of it, you're bringing it to the reasons for these, the reason that we're having economic problems, the reason that we have violence, the reason that there's corruption, and it goes back to the beginning of the St. George's Key.
Yes.
The Battle of St. George's Key. And that these things have evolved over the years, if I'm understanding you correct. It has evolved over the years and has created the problems that we are having now in Belize and throughout the world.
I know I mentioned several things in a short span of time. Mm-hmm. I talk about the decolonization process. Mm-hmm. I spoke of the historical battle that defined what we call to Belize today. That was the defining moment. Mm-hmm. And several other things that I raised, the issue of education, mm-hmm. the concept of education. Mm-hmm. And I want to bring it to a close by quoting something that Miss Sandra Cowie said once. She said that when your backs are against the wall, the rule of engagement must change. It's a powerful statement. Mm-hmm. Because when you look at Belize today and the condition of our people and our society, we are in that situation. Our backs are against the wall. Mm-hmm. Therefore, the rule of engagement must change. And this brings the issue as to why, when we look at what is going on in our society in terms of policies and planning, that nothing seems to appear to be a fundamental departure from the past or from the way we have been doing things. If you're in a mode of crisis, and we are in a mode of crisis, why are we still attempting to function as though it is business as usual? And that is why the question has arise as to the issue of justice and the implementation of justice in our society. Mm-hmm. There has been a history of this, where the issue of any type of injustice that have been done by people that hold high positions in our society has never been pursued vigorously. You fast forward it to 2008, and you are getting the same type of song and dance that we have heard previously. You are given a list of rationales as to why the pursuit of justice may or may not be in our best interest. This is a very interesting argument. It has no basis, but it's an argument that is being advanced. And so, again, coming back to the issue of when your backs are against the wall, the rule of engagement must change. And I'm saying to us that we cannot continue to function.
You have a call from Nemo Belmapan. Good night.
Yes, good night. I'm calling from the Nemo headquarters in Belmapan just to give you an update with regards to events happening with regards to the flooding. With effect from tomorrow, Tuesday, November 4th, 2008, Douglas Village in the Orange Walk District will be quarantined due to the flood waters in Douglas Village. This situation poses a serious health risk, and the village has to be evacuated. Residents must leave the area once the quarantine goes into effect. The District Emergency Committee in Orange Walk will be enforcing the quarantine. Most people have already evacuated from Douglas and are sheltering in Nueva San Juan and San Pablo, with additional people going to shelters in Nueva San Juan and San Pablo. This may create an overcrowded situation. Nemo appreciates, where possible, for evacuees to shelter with relatives or friends and to advise the District Emergency Committee where they will be staying so that Nemo can continue to provide support to them. So that's the latest information out from the Nemo headquarters here in the city of Belmapan. Again, just repeating, in case you just joined, with effect from tomorrow, Tuesday, November 4th, 2008, Douglas Village in the Orange Walk District will be quarantined due to the flood waters in Douglas Village. That situation poses a serious health risk, and the village has to be evacuated. So that's the latest information out from the Nemo headquarters here in Belmapan.
All right, thank you. We haven't really been talking about it, but it's just devastating how the floods are still happening. You know,
nature,
the water's still rising.
Nature reclaiming its itself. It's a cleansing process. You know, we as African people, we look at these things, but we shouldn't just look at it within the context of it's just a flood.
Mm-hmm. We have a call?
It's more profound.
Yes.
Caller, thanks for calling. Go ahead.
Hello, everybody. This is Sandra Foy. Thank
I thought you called Sandra. Good night.
Anyway, I just picked up the phone to call when you were making reference to my position, and I stand by that position, and I think even more so now. Everybody, whenever I try to use history, I know that it puts some people off, but we didn't invent humanity in 2008. It's been here about 6 million years, and there are rules and patterns. There are rules that have we can ascertain from the patterns that have gone before us. So I just like to tell your listeners about something before I draw the conclusion. In the 19th century, that is in the 1800s, the British decided that a statement had been made that whoever could sell oil for the lamps in China would be a man wealthy beyond all belief. So huge was the Chinese population even then. And the British set out to make that a reality with the sale of opium. Opium and heroin, they come from the same source. It is a drug that puts you to sleep, sort of. It slows down your reaction. And the British began to sell opium into China with the agreement and cooperation and connivance of Chinese authorities. And all over, particularly on the coastal plain, coastal areas, the opium then developed. All over. And as the Chinese authorities began to realize they were having a serious social problem, people were just abandoning their families and spending all day in the dens. They said to the British, we have to stop the sale of opium. Now, bear in mind that in the meantime, a bank, literally a bank, had emerged for the opium trade. It was called the Bank of Shanghai. The Chinese genuinely now, frightened at what was happening to their society, refused. And the British said, no, you can't stop now, and went to war. Actually went to war to force a nation to use drugs. And those wars are called the Opium Wars. That happened in the 19th century. The wars ended, Hong Kong went to the British for a period and everything, but the social, sociocultural destruction of China had already been set in motion. And out of that reaction, battling to solve that problem, would evolve the movement that would lead for the formation of a modern Chinese state with Sun Yat-sen and all of them. And in the late 1940s, the Chinese went to civil war. So bad was the opium situation that the wife of the last emperor, Bixi, she was an opium addict. If any of you have seen the movie The Last Emperor by Bertolucci, it shows it. Well, at the end of the 40s, the Chinese ended up in a massive civil war. On the eve of that war, there were over 10 million addicts in China. And over 10 million died in the civil war. I use that to support Nuri's position. We are in a very serious crisis in the country, not only with our black youth, but now they thought that it would begin here. It is now countrywide. It is engulfing the nation. And at the heart of it seem to be our young people and the entire industry of illicit drugs. It's caught up in that. That seems to be at the center. And I use the word seem knowingly. But the problem is that the blacks who got caught up in the drug trade got caught up, both those who are at the top of the trade, the dons, and at the lower, got caught up because of the assault on the black community, because exactly for the reasons that Nuri said, they represented the ongoing opposition. If forget about the past, particularly in the context of the Guatemalan claim, they represented it. And bear in mind that most blacks were not Catholic. They were Protestant Anglicans coming out of a culture of having opinions, voicing them, saying that is something that didn't happen in the Catholic culture and tradition. Maybe now it's developed, but not in the childhood, the years of my childhood. I grew up with an Anglican mother and a Catholic father. My mother was not a practicing Anglican, but she was a Protestant in the way she dealt with the world. Outspoken, had her opinions, very strong, would stand by them, and my father's mother came out of the Protestant tradition. Her father had come from the Bay Islands, so she had the Anglo-Protestant self-assurance, and that posed a severe problem to anybody who was attempting to mobilize the country towards inclusion in the Central American Federation that had been of the 19th century and that would now become of the modern century, SICA, and whatever all it is all about. And the blacks posed a problem, and it was necessary to neutralize, if not destroy, the black community. And not only the black community, any community in the country that posed such opposition. Hence, the destruction of Benke society. How do you explain Benke, a bright population, sharp, the people of the West are extremely racially mixed. Black and Spanish and everything is all there in Cayo. How do you explain Benke becoming virtually 90% a migrant community, as was revealed when you had the uprising in Benke over the buses? Because Benke has been consistently, they were on the border. Many of them have come from Guatemala. They are Guatemalan ancestors. And the same goes for Cuyo. There has been no place in this country more adamant in their struggle against the Guatemalan claim than the West. And come north to Orange Walk. So the tribulations and trials, the blacks have received a great portion, but I don't know if I can say they received the greatest, because there are populations that have been distributed. Now, when you come to the black population, you have to ask the question whether it's also racist, bearing in mind that the Garifuna have been traditionally, in greater part, were pro-People's United Party, or the ruling nationalist movement, generally, not all of them. Yet that community is a most impoverished, benighted one. So their problem wasn't that they were anti the ruling political ethos. Their problem must have had to be something else. The only common factor is they were black. So the situation in Belize is, as Nuri says, very complex. And let me tell you, Virginia and Yaya, mm-hmm. and Nuri, it is very hard. We have to sit to believe people. We had to see the flood to believe that the flood could happen. Well, I don't function like that, as you can well imagine, since I am always preoccupied with what happened in history. But when a people are incapable of abstracting from historical experience into their present contemporary experience, you have a serious problem. And until those people are ready and willing to do that, it's no use me or Nuri or anybody trying to get them to change, because the naysayers waiting in the wings will come right along and say, you didn't listen to that Nuri, he crazy, you know? You listen to Sandra, because she crazy, you don't know she? And you don't know she don't manage, you don't know how to get. All of these will come into play. And it has happened before.
Mm-hmm.
Because what the political forces did was look for paramount chiefs who could organize the black community. They have a problem with that with the Latin community, because they are much more diffused, but not with the black community. So that becomes an added liability. So the black community has to take a long look at itself and decide whether it wants to survive or whether it wants to die. I speak Spanish fluently. I know Guatemala. I love Guatemala as a sister nation of my region. But I love my country. This is a place I love it. And I personally declare war anytime I feel it threatened, personally. And I don't give a damn who stands in front of me. I declare war. But I can afford to love it. I was well fed as a child, loved as a child, treasured as a child, educated. We have turned willfully, and we have settled down. We have watched our young people, black in particular, but Benke and Orange War, all turned into barbarians. What's your name? These children can't read and write. How are you? People who can't read and write always in history, from ever since, put a civilization in threaten a civilization, because they are going to bring you down. The book doesn't mean a damn thing to them. The library, they burn down the library. The computer, so what? So we have a problem. Bye bye.
Thanks for
thank
the call,
you.
Sandra.
Yes.
We want to wrap now, Nuri.
Yes, well, you know, I've always had great respect for Sister Sandra Kowe. I've known her for many years, and she's one of the people that I listen to when she speaks. In closing, what I would say is that, yes, we're in a crisis. And the floods, to me, represent a cleansing process.
Mm-hmm.
That's really what it represents.
Mm-hmm.
And whether or not our leaders or leadership understands this and understand the time that we are faced with, I don't know. What I do know is that as a human being, as an individual human being, and as a member of the human family, my obligation is to stand up for self-preservation, for self-determination, and to stand up for my humanity,
mm-hmm.
regardless of who, what, or where. I mentioned the history briefly because what it illustrated clearly to me was that we have come from a long line of people who have always stood up for what is right in the face of great odds. And here we are in 2008, with all the social problems, the political problems, the economic problems, the cultural problems, the violence, all of it. This is an onslaught. This is a war. This is a war. And we need to, again to repeat, we must adjust the rule of engagement
mm-hmm.
in the time that we are living. Mm-hmm. We simply cannot continue as business as usual.
Mm-hmm.
And so, those are my parting shots. And if you allow me, I would like to leave with a very brief word
like
from
we'll
one,
tell
of
you
our
no,
great,
mm-hmm.
one of our great ancestors, who was a great fighter, Frederick Douglass.
Okay.
Okay. Frederick Douglass said, and I quote, "If there is no struggle, there is no progress. Those who profess to favor freedom and yet deprecate agitation are men who want crops without plowing up the ground. They want rain without thunder and lightning. They want the ocean without the awful roar of its many waters. This struggle may be a moral one, or it may be a physical one, or it may be both moral and physical, but it must be a struggle. Power concedes nothing without a demand, unquote.
Thank you, Brother Akbar.
You're welcome.
Miss Yaya?
Yes, we'll have Read and Reason after this. We're going back to reading the Nile Valley Contribution to Civilization. I would like to remind our listeners and viewers about the upcoming presentation on Wednesday, November 5th, 2008, from 7 to 9:15 p.m. We'll have a presentation from youths, street men, and community leaders in addressing crime and violence, also possible solutions. Some of the speakers will be from the Therese Felix Foundation, Patrick Rogers from the Commoners, youths from the Port Lola area, COLA official and citizens. Presenter would be Brother McLaurin, Jihad McLaurin, and that will be this Wednesday night from 7 to 9:15 at the Farron Felix Basketball Court on the corner of Central American Boulevard and Farber's Road. And that will be this Wednesday. And you can join us immediately after the show for Read and Reason on KREM Radio. And we're reading Nile Valley Contribution to Civilization.
And on Sunday at 4 o'clock, the UBAD Educational Foundation will have its regular monthly meeting, 4 o'clock, Jorge, at the Library of African and Indian Studies. I want to say thank you, Brother Nuri, for coming on and giving us such a well, even though you keep saying brief, it was good.
Imagine Nuri being
it was
brief.
Good. It was good. And hopefully, if you're able, then you will be back again.
Yes.
It was good having you here.
Thank you for inviting
me. All right. I want to say happy birthday to Ezekiel Young and let everybody know that the 16 days of activism against violence against women has started on November the 1st. So I want to say thank you to our technicians, Jorge Zelaya, Adwa, Jen Flowers, and Tony Grant. And with that, I'll say the struggle continues. Good night. See you next week. Same time, same place.
She's the constant wind that fills my sail. Oh, that woman. With a smile and a star, she'll protect you like a child. That's a woman.